Well, hello everyone. I love that I'm seeing our little stage full for the third speech also. Without further ado, I'm going to give some more time to Laur to speak to you guys. And yeah, have a great time.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for introducing me. And guys, first of all, I'm very happy to see so many people here. I'm actually impressed of how many people I see in the room. Thank you very much for coming. And since you are so many, and since it's my first time at HipHom and only my second time in Belgrade, should we start with a selfie? What do you think? Yes. Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm here. So everyone, hands up and say HipCon. 3, 2, 1. HipCon, hands up, hands up. Thank you. As you have probably figured out, we are going to talk about technical debt. It's not a presentation that I deliver often, but when I deliver it, there are always people who say, hey, isn't this one an old subject? Haven't we already discussed it so many times? Well, from my experience, we haven't discussed it enough. You know, I work as a consultant, and not only in Endava, the company I'm working for, but also outside Endava. And the only thing I can see is that developers and people who work in IT, they don't have yet the culture enough well-shaped to care about technical debt. I've seen in all the projects I've worked with, and I always try to teach people how to take technical debt into consideration, how to use it properly. And thanks to technical debt, I wrote this book. This is my third book. It's Troubleshooting Java. If there was no technical debt, I wouldn't have had the opportunity to use all the techniques I put in this book. And by the way, this is a paper copy that you might win if you want. Just go to the Endava booth and you will figure out what you have to do. If you are not interested in the content, it's anyway black and white and has a lot of figures, so you can use it as a coloring book as well. Well, with that being said, I feel this subject is very important. And for those of you who don't know me, by the way, the majority of people know me for either the books I wrote or my YouTube channel. But if you don't know me already, you didn't lose much. But I invite you to join me on social media, because you might have questions afterwards, and that's where you can find me wherever I am, whether I'm in Belgrade or on the other side of the world. You can always text me a message on LinkedIn, Twitter, X, or whatever it's called now, or YouTube. So what is technical debt? Technical debt is cholesterol. Yeah, why are you laughing? So cholesterol, it's something that stays with us. You can never get rid of it. But as long as your body knows how to manage it, it's fine. But in order for your body to know how to manage it, you have to actively do something. It's not coming out of the box. This is how cholesterol might look like in software. And trust me, it's not only the code. It's just an example, a simple example I could just figure out easily to put on a slide. But it's also about the dependencies. It's about the way we manage the software, the process we take, how we work as a team. Were we prepared to work online so much before the pandemics, for example? How much technical debt was introduced because we didn't know how to work online, for example? So there are so many aspects to take into consideration, from poorly written code, without rules, without indentation, without naming conventions, to using dependencies that we don't need, to the lack of upgrading our dependencies. All of these help technical debt grow from the perspective of an illness of our software. But as you will see, technical debt is not an illness if you know how to use it. And today I will tell you three stories which I find to be more representative out of the many that I have seen. And hopefully with this to describe well enough all the topics that I would like to stick with you. I'd like them to stick with you after you leave this room. So technical debt grows continuously That's why we need to actively invest time in addressing it. It's silent. It will not say anything until at the moment that we will call later bankruptcy, technical bankruptcy. So it's exactly like cholesterol. It grows silently up to the moment when you have a heart attack because of it. You will never feel cholesterol even if you don't take care of it. You will just feel it at the end. That's with software as well. And that's actually the first story I'm going to tell you. Technical debt grows like this, not linear. You don't take care of it, it will reach the line that is the technical debt. And this is the worst scenario I have ever seen as a consultant. I call this one the Italian startup because it was an Italian startup. It just happened to be an Italian startup. I will not be able to name, of course, companies, organizations I worked with, and so on. But that, this is basically how I remember it. It was years ago, not many years ago, just a few years ago, I don't know, 3-4 years ago maybe. And what happened to this project is that these guys called me and asked me to take a look on their code base, take a look on what they are doing, because they figured out they cannot serve anymore their customers. So they made promises to large organizations, to banks in Asia, which they were not able like to address anymore, because everything they were implementing seems to crash on something else. It was like a butterfly effect. You change a small line of code here, something bigger is happening elsewhere. Technical bankruptcy is when the amount that you invest in software is more than what you lose. So you basically, your software is not profitable anymore. Remember that we, in the end, the reason for which we implement software is to get profit out of it somehow. If your software is not profitable, then it's a bankrupt software. And one of the reasons, the main reasons, we end up with non-profitable software is the poorly addressed of technical debt. You say that the software is in technical bankruptcy when it reached the point where it costs more to implement than you can value out of it, so your profit is negative. And that's basically what happened to my Italian startup. There is a point of no return in technical debt. The point of no return is when you reached the line where to address the technical debt costs you more than you could take out of your investment to make it profitable. Even if you think about the future, I invest now in taking out the technical debt, it will take me too long to get back my money. If you are in that situation, you say that you are on the point of no return. So how do you find out that you are at that point? These guys called me, I've investigated their code base, their processes, and I gave them the bad news. I still remember it was a big table, their executives there, and I told them, hey, I don't have a solution for you. And of course, they got rid of me because they did, it's not what they wanted to hear. And they took a second opinion. I don't know what happened after I left. It was my investigation, like a couple of months investigation. I came with this answer. I don't know what happened afterwards, but I know that about a year, like 10 months after my collaboration with them ended, they went bankrupt. So probably I was right. It's not something that I want to tell someone, but at some point you don't have a choice. You ended up in the point of no return. Of course, people ask me, how did you find out, how can you find out if you are in the point of no return, and how can you measure profitability, how can you find out how much technical debt is there, how can you, as a consultant, give your client enough knowledge to know how they can address it, how much will it will cost them, what is the velocity they should take, and so on. And I tell them, okay, there are many metrics that I consider. It's always about metrics. If you don't have metrics, you cannot just think about the code and this is the solution. No, some things might be empirical, but you need metrics to evaluate them even empirically. One of the metrics is code churn, for example. The ratio of adding new code versus changing existing code. So you take a look at how the developers work in the project. Usually the projects are large, and you see how much code gets changed versus how much new code gets added. That is one metric. Usually new code being added more than code being changed is good. The more code is changed without too much code being added is bad. Then you have the bug rate. During development, your QA, or developers in case you don't have a dedicated QA, how many bugs are reported after the development ended, but before the software was delivered in production? Can tell you, for example, how efficient your developers are. Are they attentive on the code? Do they have a process? Are they disciplined enough? Or do you need to discipline them? Of course, there are the escape defects as well. They are even worse than the bugs discovered during development. You prefer to discover the bugs during development. It's still not a good metric. The more they are, it means your developers are not focused enough. But it's even worse if you have your users reporting the defects. So how many defects are reported outside? It's another metric you need to consider. Usually, software that is close to the point of no return will start to have more and more issues reported by the users. Frequency of hot fixes. Out of those issues reported by the users, which ones, how many woke you up at 3 a.m. and you needed to solve them at that moment because they are really, really critical? The closest the software is to a point of no return, the more you have of hot fixes like this. And yes, even if we have Kubernetes now, it's not always a restart solving the problem. Remember that. Sometimes it's actually a bug in the code, which doesn't get solved with a restart, or at least it might temporarily be fixed with a restart, but you can't rely on that. Then you have, of course, the growth of what you call technical debt, things that you know you left behind over the implementations, which is something important when you address the technical debt, especially if it's software that has already too much. Time to resolve the issues. How much time does it take for developers to resolve specific issues? The longer it is, the closer you are to the point of no return. Remember, when you solve an issue in a software that is already terminated by technical debt, you solve it somewhere, something else breaks. So the longer the time to find a solution will be, especially because many of such situations don't even have unit integration tests, end-to-end tests, and so on. Cyclomatic complexity can also give you a focus on how are your developers going with your implementation. Most of the problems have simple solutions. The more complexity you find in your code, it might turn out that those solutions are not well implemented. Also, with high cyclomatic complexity, it's difficult to implement tests. So the highest the cyclomatic complexity becomes, the lowest usually the level of unit and integration testing is, which means that in the future, it will be more difficult for you to find out if you can implement something without having the fear of breaking something else, so going into a butterfly effect. Then, of course, dependency analysis. How many of you do analyze their dependencies in code? Do you have that in your pipeline? Too few hands, from my perspective. You should always have that in your pipeline. You should have tools, plugins for your whatever sonar you use. I don't care because tools are not important for our discussion now. I don't want to mean a tool is better than another. But whichever tool you use, you should measure this stuff. All of this that I have given you, but dependencies are also important. We need to know, are our dependencies secure? Do we need to update them? Or do we even need them? you can calculate the number of lines of code that are used in your code base from a specific dependency. I remember years ago, at some point, I have figured out that there was a strange dependency in my code. And then I tried to figure out where is it used. It turned out it was used like in only one place, where someone used a constant out of their dependency to replace the empty string. So it was like some class dot empty string. That was the only place in the code base that dependency was used. Of course, that's not good. Yeah, we have a lot of memory. You don't care about blueprint, about footprint anymore of your application. That's not right, especially now because we deliver our apps in clouds. The footprint of the application, the larger it is, the more costly it becomes. And calculate that throughout time. You will see how much cost you add to your application just because you use unnecessary stuff there. It's not a matter of just let IntelliJ add that dependency because now you had that option. Find it automatically. The dependency, you put it in your POM XML or whatever you use, and then suddenly you use a dependency just to replace an empty string somewhere. And of course, code coverage. Do we have unit, integration tests, mutation tests? I will not go into detail. I probably you've heard this too many times already of how important tests are. But aside from tests, which serve as the possibility to figure out when you break something and of course serve as documentation as well, how much of the product documentation is obsolete? You need to have product documentation in place. And you know which is the first part of the application that the developers skip when they are pushed by managers to implement stuff fast enough? Documentation, of course. I mean, we need to put that thing in production. Why should we care about documentation? If you make a habit out of this, then you will end up with no documentation. Or even worse, documentation that is lying. You look into the documentation, you find something, you look in the code, you see something else, you don't know how to implement it further, and it takes you more time to figure out because of the documentation that exists, rather than if it was no documentation there. Having bad documentation is worse than having no documentation. So documentation decay is important. And of course, another KPI that you need to measure when you try to figure out where are you in terms of point of no return is the team morale. Just ask the team of developers, how do you feel on writing this code? You will find out more than if you count the number of bugs, trust me. So main reasons, I'm not sure why that's small, probably something changed in my phones here, but I will try to read them. So inadequate training, rushed deadlines, insufficient documentation, old tech stack, varied code practices, so you don't have a discipline and a documented process, neglected testing, of course, and improper architecture. They are the, say, common causes of technical debt. So remember that in order not to get to the point of no return, there is something that you have to do about this cholesterol. The reason the first part is about your health is because I still consider that your health is more important than the product. So I wanted to put it there as well. I want it to be the first column. First, take care about yourselves. So take care about cholesterol. That's more important. But take care about also the software's cholesterol. So keep your software with a discipline in place in such a way in which you will always have software cholesterol, but it will never be at the point where it can get you to the point of no return. It will get you bankrupt. When we learn software in faculty or wherever we learn it, trainings and so on, we tend to be fooled by the fact that we always implement projects for a short term. And I say short term, it's like you implement it, you use it for a week, you got the mark, it's no longer important. And we grow with a mentality that makes us believe that maybe this is also what happens in the real world. But in the real world, when you build software, you build it to be there for 10, 20, 30 years, maybe even more. You always have to think about that. And that's why we need to put technical debt as a priority together with our business implementations. So maybe you want to ask, since we do have always technical debt, is there a way to use it wisely? Okay, there is. So let me tell you a second story. The second story is about a company where a project where I was forced to somehow use technical debt, but in a financial perspective, not as a sickness, and knowing very well what I have to do. How? Imagine this simple scenario. You want to buy the house of your dreams, and you figure out you don't have enough money. What do you do? Of course, you can always borrow some money from the bank. But when you do that to buy your house of your dreams, you always know what you are doing, and you always keep in mind that you will have a debt to the bank. You will pay more in the end than the value of the house because you borrowed time. When you go to a bank and borrow money, you don't really borrow money. You may have created that money, but you borrowed the time needed to create that money. Instead of waiting for 10 years to put that money apart to buy the house or whatever it would have taken you, you lent the money and then you actually borrowed the time. So that's what I had to do for this second project, which I call it hard to decommission. In the second project, my customer was using an application that was provided by some other company, and for which they were paying a very expensive license. We talk about millions of dollars. So what happens with this kind of applications that are created by someone and then other organizations pay licenses for them is that at some point, and especially today, you figure out that in order to have a proper velocity of your organization, of your business, of your strategy, you need to push on those guys to build you the stuff as fast as you need it. And very often, they cannot do that, because sometimes they start having too many clients, so their teams cannot put enough code with the right velocity to keep up with your velocity of an organization to have your own strategy. So what do you decide to do in that case? You decide to get rid of those guys and build your own software, because you will be able to build your own strategy without having to wait for those to build the strategy for 1,000 other companies. But there is a problem with this. You can't simply just get rid of a software that you are using. First of all, these licenses are very expensive. Secondly, they are not paid like you pay your Zoom subscription per month or your Netflix subscription. You pay it per year, per 5 years, per 10 years. So in this case, it was an yearly paid license, which was very expensive. So how can you implement your software such way in which you end up with an minimum viable product, an MVP, in less than 1 year, such that you can get rid of the list of the license, because you cannot afford to invest also in a license and in a team of developers, because we talk about a lot of money, okay? So I offered them the possibility. I told them I will leave technical debt behind and I will borrow time, same as I would borrow money from a bank when buying a book, when buying a house, sorry. So I will do that. And I did that, and we ended up with a working MVP and a lot of technical debt, but I told them from the very beginning, the next thing you will let me do after I finish with the MVP is addressing the technical debt. And fortunately, they understood that, and I trusted them, and they trusted me. Because what you can do is, of course, this is a nice quadrant that I stolen from ThoughtWorks, is when you deal with technical debt, you can choose different perspectives. You can deliberately leave technical debt, or you can not be aware when you leave it. And I was there. I was deliberately leaving the technical debt. You can be reckless, like, let's do this fast, but with a good economical reason. Or you can be, of course, very prudent, but you can't do that in my situation where I was there. Depending on your situation or of the customer or of the product you are working on, you should be on one of these quadrants. There is no good or bad in this quadrant. The good or bad depends on exactly your situation. It doesn't mean that if I was there on teams go for speed over quality without considering the downsides, in my case made sense. So remember, technical depth may make sense, but you have to properly be able to address it and be very mindful of the following. The company's culture, meaning the organization you are working with. There are sometimes managers that will tell you, yes, we are going to address that technical debt after. And then they don't do that. If you don't trust them, you might end in the situation. You have to persuade them enough to understand that if they will address the situation in that way, they will fail. Be careful of the politics. I mean, the discussions, again, which happen at the top level. It really matters if the top level, the top management understands technicalities, rather if they are just some guys looking on some papers, on some numbers, and they say, hey, if this costs me now more, we can stay. We have working software. Why should we consider this anymore? It costs us some numbers. If they don't understand the long term, then it's a problem. And of course, be careful what kinds of contracts you sign. Okay. Some, if you're for a company, maybe it's not something you care, but if you work as an independent consultant, then it's definitely something you care about. But there comes the story number three, which is also our last story. And I want you to figure out, and also remember in the quadrant you have seen before, is that there is also the possibility that you are trying to overachieve. Remember that it's still profitability that is important. Your scope is not highly qualitative software. Your scope is maybe highly qualitative, but not perfect software. Or it depends on what you consider to be high or not. But don't try to polish it too much. Because if you try to polish it too much, you might fail in the situation where you even delay feature implementation that will bring you money, you, meaning your organization you're working for, that your software will bring money just to polish stuff that is not needed. When we work on code, for example, our brains are made to be iterative. You will never anyway be able to achieve perfection from the beginning. It's better if you take an iterative approach. Of course, do as much as you can for your software now, but don't try to make too much by delaying stuff. I also had a situation where the teams were actually procrastinating work on businesses just because they had a process in place that they were forcing them to take care of things that were not even essential. Like, for example, they had a process where they had to run every SQL script they were creating through a different department, or a different DB department. So if you wanted to write a simple insert in your flyway, you had to run that insert through a different department just for them to tell you, hey, this is fine, you can run this. Be careful not to go into exactly that direction, okay? So it's a line where it's you make the difference between being too careful, where your software might become less profitable. So over-polishing, of course, might cause delays in project delivery, might cause missed deadlines, which in the end might cause costs, stagnation in future development, and of course, all of them will have financial implications. So quality is important, but be mindful of timely delivery as well, so calculate your velocity. As I was telling you earlier, iterative development is a good approach always, because that's how our minds work. And if you try to figure out from the beginning always which is the perfect architecture, perfect code design, that's the point where you might reach something that's called analysis paralysis. Okay? You analyze too much before putting the thing in place. If you find yourself really not knowing what to do, at least try a POC. But there is something you should do, like physically do it yourself. Don't just stay look at the papers. So some conclusions before I end and take the questions for you. Be mindful of the nature of technical debt. Sometimes technical debt is left behind on purpose. Sometimes you don't know about it. Avoid trying to have technical debt that you don't know about it by using proper metrics. Act balanced between polishing versus implementing, have an iterative approach, have metrics in place, as I said earlier, have a holistic strategy. So remember that dependencies, ways of working are also part of the technical debt and not only lines of code. And of course, be mindful of the business implications, because profitability is the one that is the most important in most cases. With that being said, I'm ready for your questions, and I have a couple of them already in the app, but maybe there is someone who wants to ask something before from the room. No hands up. Are you shy? Where is my phone? I don't know where I left my phone, but I had like, oh, here it is, a couple of questions. Or do you want to read them for me? Okay, fine enough. Any tips of preventing a task project from becoming a technical debt, aka how to showcase this task project can tap in into the business needs, even if sometimes you don't see a clear path to it? So I guess that this question is about things like, how the heck do I convince my manager that I have to upgrade from Java 11 to Java 17 or 21? Because this doesn't look like a business implementation that will bring us money, no? So I think this is it about, if the one who asked this question is here and is not that, please let me know. And but if this is the one, then of course it's a very good question. I think it's something that all of us encounter more than once in the projects we are working on. The persuasion is the most important, with putting first on paper all the things that will happen on medium and long term, with usually examples from the past if you have. So take as an example, hey, we look what happened to that company who didn't upgrade struts from version X to Y. They ended up with a vulnerability and they ended up losing a lot of money and image. You find that on the news, so you can do that. You can just search and see this kind of stuff. You tell them, upgrading is not only because we like to always be on the latest version, which is hot and sexy. Of course, it's also about that. But it's not only about the new features that will be able to make your like maybe code shorter. Like if you work with Java, we know it's a verbose language, but with the newest version now it's less verbose, so let's use that. It comes with different features like text blocks and stuff that will help us. You have to put on paper these advantages but also the disadvantages and tell them, on the medium term you might be able to achieve this task, but if you don't upgrade, you will have to do that later. And instead of taking you a week to make the upgrade, it will take you 2 months to make the upgrade. So calculate how much will you lose actually by making the upgrade later than if you do it now, and you will observe that you will actually end up on a medium term losing more if you don't make the upgrade rather than if you make the upgrade. That's how I'm doing it. So I'm trying to find the different examples, real examples, put them on the plate. And there will always be situations where they will not understand. Again, I'm just like a doctor. I tell to my patient, this is what you should do, but if the patient doesn't listen, you don't have to be upset on yourself about that, no? What is your preferred setup for greenfield projects so that technical debt is kept low? Very good question. I actually started the last greenfield project about 4 months ago. I always have one word for this: discipline. I create discipline in terms of, in the beginning, you have a new team and you see developers work differently because that's how they worked in their previous projects. Now they are grouped together and you will see differences. Some of them will work, will have their ways of writing the unit tests. Some others will have different ways. Some of them will have their ways of writing the code. Some others have their different ways. So what I do is, in the first weeks, even days if I can, of the new started project, I put some technical meetings, I call them. I'm not sure if it's the right name or not. We discuss with the whole team the things we start from, and we create a process that we enhance in the next weeks and months being starting to become a mature one, like usually a few months from when we began. But then we stick to that, and we have code reviews, so we make sure that everyone sticks to that process. And if someone doesn't stick to the process, and they have a right argument for why they aren't sticking to the process, we may adapt the process. But the thing is always discipline, and the greenfield projects are always the best to do that, because you have the chance to put from the beginning a process and create a discipline. It's much more difficult when you get a legacy project where this didn't ever happen. Yes.
We don't have time for the last question.
We don't have time.
Could you maybe answer it?
Yes. So, for the last question, which was only added now, I think, as I didn't see previously, you can find me at the Endava booth, and you can find me also tomorrow, and you can find me also on social media. So, please follow me if you want to talk more with me later. And sorry for not being able to answer all your questions. I'm always talking a lot. But thank you very much again for having me here.